Please stand as you are able and join me for the call to worship. As we gather this day, each of us brings something to worship. We bring the burdens of the week. We bring prayers of hope and prayers of anguish. We bring our voices and our offerings and our questions. We bring our faith, tattered or whole as it may be. We bring all this to each other and to God, whom we worship today. You may be seated. Please join me in the prayer of confession. O God, who loves us, hear our prayer. So often we come to you for the right words, the right deeds, the right feelings. We know all is not right, but we cannot say with certainty what is wrong. There are deep divisions between us and others. There is war and terror and too little peace. Creator and Redeemer, make things right with us and to make us right with you and each other. May we seek forgiveness and wholeness from those we have wronged. Listen to our hearts and make plain our journey. And now for the assurance of grace. As the sun rises in the morning, as the cool breeze ushers in the evening, as the light of noonday is diffused in our Pacific Northwest sky, and the leaves begin their surrender to show us it can be beautiful to fall. God is here, beloved. God is present with us.
Good morning. And welcome to Plymouth Church, United Church of Christ. We're so happy to be in worship with you this morning. If there are guests or people for whom this is your first time, I'd invite you to raise your hand. We'd love to say welcome. Welcome. We're so happy to have you with us this morning. We have a small token of our appreciation for you being here with us this morning. As is our custom, we offer a land and labor acknowledgement, knowing that this is a small part of our work together, or just a beginning of our work together rather than a small part. Plymouth Church acknowledges that we occupy the unceded land of its first stewards, the Duwamish of the Coast Salish people. We vow our solidarity with the Duwamish in their honorable quest to become a federally recognized tribe. Plymouth Church also offers a labor acknowledgement for the African American enslaved upon whose backs this country gained much of its wealth, as well as the work and the lives of other minoritized people who emigrated to this country. In our journey to become more fully the church, we honor our social location of power and privilege, and our position to do justice within our church and in the world. And we recognize that such a statement is only the beginning of the work to which we are called. Amen. A few other announcements. After the service this morning, we invite you to stick around for our concert with our artist in residence, EB. We are excited to hear what you have to offer. I'm sure it will be wonderful. That will happen about 15 minutes after the service ends here in the sanctuary. And then finally, today we have a moment of ministry. I'll invite Tracy Simpson, our Plymouth moderator, to introduce our social justice and action survey.
Good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you. I see you online a lot when y'all are passing the peace and the camera is panning, and you know, it's wonderful to be here with you. So some of you may have seen in the Herald this week the announcement that in collaboration with the clergy team, the church council is hoping to sort of re-energize Plymouth's hands-on, out in the community, kind of hands and feet of Jesus work to support social justice. In part, we want to find out what people are doing and also what folks might be interested in doing and coming together to do through Plymouth. And so you're welcome to complete the survey online. I think several of you have, maybe many of you have, I'm not quite sure. And we also have paper copies here available and some lovely little pencil, sharpened pencils that are out on the table. But basically, you know, I think a lot of us came to Plymouth because of the strong social justice, social action presence that we've had in the community for decades. And, you know, COVID's really kind of taken a hit, I think, with COVID. And as we start coming through and as we figure out how to be safe in community with each other, we want to get us back going together. And so you'll note that this survey is not anonymous. We actually want your names, we want your contact information, because we want to essentially do some matchmaking. You know, we want to help folks who are interested in the same things find each other and, you know, and then, you know, figure out kind of where to go from there. So please go ahead and, you know, fill out the survey here on paper if you want, or online. And then the last thing I'll note is that if you are somebody who has experience with any of the things that are listed, and you're willing to talk with folks who are interested in either joining or carrying the torch forward, you know, please let us know that too, because we know that we've got a lot of really, we've got a lot of depth of knowledge and expertise and experience with these things, and we want to make sure that we're not just like starting from scratch, because we don't need to. Okay, so thank you in advance. We're gonna tally the results after November 12th. We're gonna ask that you get us the surveys by then. We'll tally the results and let folks know in the Herald kind of what's going on, and we will figure out a way to get people connected who have shared interests. So thanks for this time.
And now, as we continue in worship, a favorite time of mine, and I think many of yours, the passing of the peace, I will invite you, though, we'll keep things a little bit brief, say hello, wave to a few people around you, because we do have a packed service this morning. But with that said, may the peace of Christ be with you all. Thank you. You'll notice Joe kindly played the piano without expecting me up here to sing. We'll save you from that. As we continue in worship, I invite you to join me in prayer. This morning's prayer will begin with an excerpt from Psalm 61 from Dr. Gaffney's translation. If you'll join me. Hear my cry, God. Be attentive to my prayer. From the end of the earth to you I call when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you, O God, are a refuge to me, a strong tower against the enemy. May I abide in your tent for all time. May I find refuge under the shelter of your wings. For you, God, have heard my vows. You have granted the heritage of those who fear your name. Holy One, this morning, as on each of our mornings, we come to you in prayer. We come to you hoping to abide in your tent for all time, hoping to find refuge under the shelter of your wings, knowing, O God, that you do not forsake us. Knowing, O God, that you have called each of us in this time and in this place, even when our hearts are faint. It is easy, O God, to look around your world, your creation, and to see so much heartache and so many things we can only lift to you in prayer. We see the violence and the bloodshed in Israel and Palestine, and sometimes it feels hopeless. But even this we lift to you, O God. We lift to you, O God, those people in Maine who lost their lives at the hand of a gun, knowing that we, your people, have not done enough to end gun violence, and knowing that you grieve each time a life is taken. There are so many things, O God, for which we pray. So many prayers that cling close to our hearts, and that only you, O God, can put words to. We lift all of these prayers and more to you. It is in Jesus' name that we say, Amen. As we lift our prayers, we are cognizant of those on the Plymouth prayer list, which you will now see scrolling. As is our custom, I invite you to join me in the prayer of Jesus. Our parent, who is among us, blessed be your creation. May your loving presence be a reality here on earth. May we become more interested in building your kingdom here and now than in waiting for it to come down from above. Let us share our bread with those who hunger. Let us learn to forgive as well as to receive forgiveness. Help us through the time of temptation, delivering us from all evil. For ours are the eternal blessings that you pour upon the earth. Amen.
Bless us all. Dear friends, one of the greatest powers each of us has is the power of choice. Our choices matter, and this time of offering, it's one of the ways God encourages us to be generous. So let us choose to give for the care and the blessings of others. I invite those of you who are in the sanctuary with us today to come forward with your gifts. There are baskets on the table before you. And if you are online, please follow the instructions and give cheerfully and generously. Thank you. Let us pray together the prayer of dedication. God of life, we choose to live fully, and in doing so, we choose to be givers. May our resources grow and reach those most in need. Amen. You may be seated. And now is the time where we invite your voice to participate in worship with our contemporary voice, which comes to us from the poet Lucille Clifton. I am accused of tending to the past. Is there one who will read for us this morning? Catherine, please. I don't think you have to check, just stride forward. It's yours.
I got my back.
All right. For this, we say thank you. It's here, but either one.
I am accused of tending to the past. I am accused of tending to the past as if I made it, as if I sculpted it with my own hands. I did not. This past was waiting for me when I came, a monstrous, unnamed baby. And I, with my mother's itch, took it to breast and named it history. She is more human now, learning languages every day, remembering faces, names, and dates. When she is strong enough to travel on her own, beware, she will.
Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from 1 Kings, selected passages. Now King David was old, advancing in days, so although they covered him with clothes, he did not get warm. Then his servants said to him, "Let them seek for my lord, the king, a virgin girl, and let her stand in the presence of the king and service him. Let her lie in your bosom and warm my lord, the king." So they searched for a beautiful girl throughout the whole territory of Israel and found Abishag the Shunammite, and they brought her to the king. Now the girl was very beautiful, and she became the king's service woman and attended him, yet the king did not know her sexually. Then Adonijah, son of Haggith, exalted himself, saying, "I will reign." He commissioned for himself chariots and horsemen and 50 men to run ahead of him. Then Nathan said to Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, "Have you not heard that Adonijah, son of Haggith, reigns, and our Lord David does not know? Come now, therefore, let me counsel you, please, so that you may save your life and the life of your son Solomon. Come, go to King David and say to him, 'Did you not, my lord the king, swear to your slave woman, saying, "Your son Solomon shall reign. Your son Solomon shall reign after me, and he shall sit on my throne"? Why then does Adonijah reign? Look, while you are still there speaking with the king, I myself will come after you and confirm your words." So Bathsheba went to the king's room. Now the king was very old, and Abishag the Shunammite was attending to the king. Bathsheba bowed and prostrated herself before the king, and the king said, "What do you wish?" She said to him, "My lord, you swore to your slave woman by the Holy One of old, your God, saying, 'Your son Solomon shall reign after me, and he shall sit on my throne.' Yet now look, Adonijah reigns now, and my lord the king, you know it not. The king swore and said, as the eternal one lives, who has ransomed my life from every trouble, as I swore to you by the faithful one, the God of Israel, your son Solomon shall reign after me, and he shall sit on my throne in my place. Therefore, thus shall I do this day. Then Bathsheba bowed with her face to the ground and prostrated herself before the king and said, may my lord King David live forever. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Comfort, comfort. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy One, it is difficult to be fully present. Difficult to be fully present in this moment. When so many things are swirling in our minds, and some of us are angry, and some of us are afraid, and some of us are thinking about what we talked about moments before we came in. Some of us are preoccupied about what we are planning to do. And some of us are deeply impacted. And what we're going through is so loud, it's difficult to be here. But, oh God, you call us by your Spirit to enter into these moments so that we might hear a word from on high that may change and transform us and also deposit enough hope in us that we might live on and see what the end will be. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. And the people of God said, Amen. To everything, there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. And a time to break down and dismantle and a time to build up. There's a time to weep and a time to dance. A time to rend and a time to sew things together. A time for silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. This is familiar poetic scripture to many of us coming out of Ecclesiastes, spoken most often at memorials. And it is a reminder on this day that in the journey of our living, we must know that there is indeed a time for everything. If we got here, we will indeed die. And yet we find ourselves in the conundrum between life and death, figuring out by hook and by crook how to stretch and extend life as far as humanly possible. Sometimes we do it by spiritual practice, by meditation, by eating right. Sometimes it's a nick and a tuck that you may share with your friends and perhaps not. For others, it's a sports car or a trip to Bali in the midst of your middle life crisis. And for others, we use science as best we can and whatever other resource we can find to improve the quality of our lives and extend it as far as we are able. And our efforts have been quite successful, as many of us are living longer than ever. However, today's scripture is inviting us to another conversation. This scripture is inviting us to consider who and how we will be at the point of death. It's inviting us to think about what comfort looks like for us and for those around us. So I say, comfort, comfort. In today's scripture, we meet our friend David. We have to claim David because many of us are like him. Some of us are even named for him. And he is literally on his deathbed after living about 3 or 4 whole lives at once. And David is so cold, so close to what my grandmother would say, the chilly Jordan, that he cannot get warm. They are piling, heaping blankets upon him. And nothing's working. So what do they do? Certainly they must have called for a priest. Nope. They searched instead for a beautiful woman to be his comfort girl, to lie next to him and keep him warm and perhaps perk him up a little bit so that he can, even in this time of death, present as king. They found a beautiful woman and brought her from her family so that she could lay next to King David and keep him warm. Interestingly, there are many unnamed women, but she has a name, Abishag. Say her name, Abishag, Abishag. And she was pulled out of her life to simply lay still. They weren't concerned about if she had a degree or any skills or anything. They just wanted her to be in the bed with him as David lay dying. And today, after hearing the Reverend Dr. Will Gaffney lecture last night at First Baptist Church, Lord have mercy, you should have been there, my God. I wonder what we owe Abishag. I wonder what we owe her, the one who was brought by force. I'm sure that she was not on a dating app swiping right and found David. I think she was taken by force and was brought to the palace to tend to the dying. She wasn't a hospice nurse. She wasn't someone who was aware of palliative care. She was brought in to lay her warm young body next to David and invigorate him, to bring him back to life for the purposes of many. See, folks didn't want David to die yet because there were still things to do. People didn't want David to die yet because he represented power. They didn't want David to die, for things to change from what they knew and loved. And even in his obvious impotence, they were trying to do what they could to keep him alive. They needed David to hold on a little longer because he didn't even know who was ruling his kingdom. His oldest child said, "Oh, Daddy, almost dead. Let me get my chariot then, and let me find 50 people in a gold suit of armor." He was dressing up, just ready for his father to die. And David hadn't a clue. They needed him to hold on a little longer, and so they wanted to comfort him and keep him alive. Dear friends, who are the comfort people in our midst? Because you know that we aren't just talking about an ancient story. Who are the ones that we employ to prop us up and stitch things together and make things go on a little bit longer so that the things that we know and love, the things that we are nostalgic about, can remain in existence a little bit longer, at least wait until we die for things to change? We ask for change, but not like that. We must understand that this story is essentially an ancient version of a white supremacist culture tenet. the right to comfort. This church actually made a commitment to do this work, friends, so this should not be a new thing for us. The right to comfort, for those who don't know, is a characteristic of white supremacy culture, as I said, where those in power believe they should never be made to feel uncomfortable. It's the state of being where their emotional and psychological comfort should always be prioritized over the real and dire harms of the people of color and other minoritized people whose equity is at risk. In practice, if a person of color or a minoritized person, in this case, queer, trans, women, disabled people, all the folks of the spectrum, if they make someone in power uncomfortable, you will already see the cogs start to move and the machines start to work, because they will be scapegoated and demonized and more than likely removed. Somebody say ouch. And the story will be told, because people aren't creative. And the systems happen over and over again. And the testimonies of those who have been DEI executives who come in one year and leave the next and are said to be ineffective, they will tell you that even though their resumes were stacked to the gills, that they will tell the story that they were ineffective and without proper skill. And they will be focused on as the reason that things are as they are, rather than the active racism that is alive in the organization or institution. They will be told that it was because they didn't do what they were asked to do. They didn't follow the policies. They'll even create new ones just so that they can get rid of the person that stands in their way of keeping David alive. And it looks like shifting the circumstances for perpetual wins at all costs. And we have the nerve to talk about bullies in schools when the children learn to bully from us. It looks like making sure the favored win and the least lose. We don't care how, we just want it. It looks like commodifying minoritized people, always using their gifts, always using their skills, always using their intelligence and their bodies for the comfort of keeping what we've known alive. But if they get out of line, get out of here. Comfort, comfort, Abishag. Comfort, comfort to all of you who have found yourself in her position. We have to ask who we're using to keep comfort. And of course, I'm thinking about the Korean women who were comfort women during World War II. And I'm thinking about African American children whose their enslavers would put their feet on them to drain the arthritis out of their bodies into the bodies of the children for their comfort. I'm thinking about who are we laying on or laying next to keep the body of institutions and systems alive, just to keep them warm enough so that they can still appear to be strong. What of the vibrant and beautiful people who are just going on about their lives, just trying to live their lives without getting bombed, just trying to live their lives without being raped, just trying to live their lives like Abishag, but somehow are pulled into the service of trying to prop up something that will die anyway? The scriptures say she was quite beautiful, but what did it matter? She just needed to be a warm body to fill David's bed and to serve his purposes. She was objectified, period. Like Vanna White. Come on, friends, I love seeing her turn the letters, but can't we give her a break? And the scriptures state, as translated by Reverend Dr. Gaffney, that she was used, but not sexually. Dr. Gaffney is a trip, y'all. You really have to see her in person. I will be having lunch with her shortly, and I just am so grateful for the ways that she just says a thing and lets it go. And she highlights that the woman, Abishag, is safe, at least sexually, because at this point, David is impotent. He doesn't know what's going on, and he also is not the man of his younger days. He's shaking and cold, piled with blankets. And so in this case, she was safe, at least sexually, but she still was not safe. How many of you know that she wasn't safe? And then there are verses that are cut out, but the prophet Nathan is still around, and Nathan employs Bathsheba, a woman who was seen, remember, on top of a building, and David said, "Ooh, she fine and chocolate. I want to have sex with her," and did a whole thing so that he might do it, even killing her husband. Nathan called Bathsheba and said, "Look, you've got to make this right, because David's oldest son is not the one that's supposed to be king. Solomon is." So Bathsheba became a comfort woman again, and she was called to do the work to make sure that she was upholding the nation. Dear friends, we have to admit that there are whole organizations that manage itself so that they are not too effective, because they don't want to get rid of the population that they're using to stay in business. Ooh, somebody need to, wow. Let's talk about the nonprofit industrial complex. Let's talk about the military industrial complex. There's always going to be people to bomb. Let's talk about it. Let's ask the ones who die without a tear shed for them, as long as it is in comfort of those we like. Let us think about Sudan. Come on, friends. How many of you knew that they've been in war for 190 plus days? Have we even considered about the women, 48 an hour, that are raped? No, because our media is focusing on something else. But like David, many of us are in the throes of death. We are cold, we are anxious, we are shaking, in need of comfort and blankets. But we're doing this while also choosing who deserves comfort and making sure that we track warm bodies of humans just so we need them, so that we can exploit them and lay them on top of the churches and institutions and circumstances that are dying as we need them to do. This is why we have a prayer of confession, dear friends, not simply because we're trying to add another feature to the liturgy, but because we know that if we are human, we have always got to confess some sin that we have done or perpetuated, even by our indifference or our silence. Come on, friends. This is why we confess. We are confessing because we have decimated the earth. We are confessing because we haven't told the truth about who we are. We are confessing because we can have a film that says Seattle is dying, but the church has not figured out how to create its own media to say that Seattle is alive. Why don't we tell the story of how we are loving and compassionate and how we will build this city together? We have to understand that too many people die because they are maintaining the comfort that will not be shared with them. We have to understand that people of every distinction are impacted as we ask them to hold up this vision of cis heteronormative, able-bodied, masculine, land-owning fantasy. We have to understand that we pull people out of a potential life in order to sustain the lives of those we deem important and those we deem as precious. So Abishag, our service workers, dear friends, Abishag, she's the one who grows our food. She's the one who picks and prepares it. She represents the minoritized people who dare to be in community with dominant culture people, even though they are harmed time and time again. She is the one who has to work under the table because we don't have sensible immigration policies that allow people to work in this country if they have immigrated here. She's that person. She's the woman who still can't get anywhere close to pay equity, even though she works twice as hard. Comfort, comfort to Abishag. For we have to speak in tones that won't scare anyone. We have to smile even when we've cried. And if someone hurts our feelings, we have to say, I'm sorry you hurt my feelings. And no one checks in with Abishag. They just assume that she has all the qualities she needs to care for herself. So we say, pace yourself and do self-care, because certainly having a facial is going to make you forget the heartache and trauma. Bow and shrink and pretend as if you know what you have been called to do. And then we try to say the people who ask this of us are strong. We have to pretend as if the one who requires this of Abishag, of you and me, they aren't the weakest thing this side of a spineless jellyfish just born yesterday. We have to pretend. And one mistake humans are making is that we assume that God is asking for us to rid ourselves of anxiety. We assume that we are always supposed to be comfortable, but we must know that God is calling the church to speak truth to power, to never shy away from telling the truth, to go to the mayor's office and go to the governor's office and speak to those with power, and to say that we will study war no more, and to call for a ceasefire, and to say, let the hostages go. And we are called to speak on black and brown and other folks' behalf, and we are called to speak on behalf of the elders. We are called to build buildings for LGBTQ folks who are elders and have nowhere to go. We are called to be the church. And this is our good news, that we can be David. Because even in David's weakened state, David propped up a little bit and became invigorated and found his energy and did what he needed to do for the sustaining of his nation. And we can do the same. I hope that we will always look to provide comfort for those who truly deserve it and call ourselves in when we are trying to comfort ourselves because we don't believe we have the strength to see change in our lifetime. Because to everything there is a season, dear friends, a time and a purpose under heaven, a time to plant and a time to pluck up. There's a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break it down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. It's a time to rend and break apart and a time to sew it back together, a time to keep silent. But now is the time to speak. So let us speak in this time of war, that there can be peace and there can be justice, and that God's reign does not look like war, but it looks like love. And I hope that we can do it together. You and I, let us be the ones who say to those most vulnerable, most marginalized, most disenfranchised, comfort. Ah. Comfort. Amen. Thank you all for participating in worship this day. Worship is an act to stitch us together, a moment of reconciliation in this world torn apart. So thank you for the peace that you have brought to me, to others, and to the world. And now for the benediction. May God bless you with discomfort. Discomfort at easy answers and half-truths and superficial relationships. Discomfort so that you will live deep within your heart. Oh, may God bless you with anger. Anger at injustice and oppression and exploitation of people. Anger so that you will work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears. Tears to shed for those who suffer pain and rejection, starvation and war. Tears so that you will reach out to comfort them and turn their pain into joy. And may God bless you with foolishness. Foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in the world. Foolishness so that you will do what others claim cannot be done. Amen. Please be seated for the benediction.